This episode of Fireside Chat is brought to you by TickTix. Buying tickets shouldn't be anonymous. We are built for fans, by fans. Available on Android and iOS. Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another Fireside Chat, the official podcast of Flames fans. It's go time.
Well, a great week of Flames hockey is behind us, and the Flames are now 500 on their record. They are tied for the Western Conference and 3 points out from the number one, two spots in the Pacific Division. And as always, I'm Dan alongside Matt. Matt, what's happened? Like, we went from being a team that was at the bottom of the West to now competing for a playoff spot.
Well, a good prolonged winning streak will do that for you, and it's about time that the team figured out the system, and they've responded ever since Johnny Gaudreau went down with injury, and they had fun when he returned.
See, and looking at the team without Gaudreau, I thought if this team can win without their best player, imagine what's going to happen when he comes back. And I think it's just a lot of pieces that have been all clicking at the same time. We've seen Chad Johnson really emerge as the starter during that time. We've seen guys step up. We saw better chemistry with Monahan versus Stieg, so it's going to be really interesting to see what happens over the next week.
For sure. And the thing that I was interested by during the Ducks game was the fact that the coaching staff separated all of the quality players on different lines. Like, you had Versteeg with Monahan and Brouwer, you had Bennett with Gaudreau and Chiasson, and of course the Tkachuk, Backlund, and Frolik line. And you could see in that Ducks game that it was giving the coaching staff fits because of the fact that you can't cover everybody with your best defenseman. And that was allowing some of the players to actually get prime matchups and resulting in one of the most bizarre games I've seen recently from the Flames.
Before we get into talking about that game and the other two this week, just looking around at where this team is now, you and I have both flip-flopped a little bit back and forth. Where do you feel as far as playoffs go now? You think this team can make it?
Well, I thought that they were a playoff team from the get-go this season, and now with this winning streak, all it has done is hit the reset button on the season to date. They have 28 points in 28 games. They're 1 point behind Anaheim, 3 points behind both the Oilers and Sharks for the division lead. And now it's just a matter of seeing whether they can take advantage over the next month and a half with the schedule being slightly easier and taking it to those lesser teams. Like, if you look at the next 12 games for Calgary, they play six of them against Colorado, Vancouver, and Arizona.
Should be easier games.
Should be. But as we saw with Philadelphia and the Islanders, that doesn't necessarily translate.
So, I mean, we talked earlier in the season about Darren Hines doing the math that it often takes about 20 games for a team to adjust to a new coach, and the Flames are now 28 games into the season. So it would make sense now if what we're seeing is what we're going to get this year.
Yeah, and back in preseason when I was examining the system that the coaching staff was trying to deploy out there, this is what I was seeing in terms of the structure. And you could tell in the first 10 or so games of the regular season that if you look back at last year when Dougie Hamilton first arrived, it was that same, I'm not familiar with the system at all, so there was some hesitancy in his game. Well, instead of it just being him, it was the entire team being off because they weren't sure what they were supposed to do, and they were kind of alternating between the old system and the new system, and it takes a while for things like that to just become instinctual instead of taking that half a second to think of, oh, I'm supposed to do this, not that. And that's what led to a lot of the goals against in pretty much all of the early games in the season.
For sure. Well, let's break down this week. I agree with you that I think the Flames on paper at the beginning of this year look like a playoff team. And I think if they keep playing the way they are, it's a weaker Pacific Division. I think this team's going to have no problems getting into the postseason.
Yeah, and that's a secondary benefit of being in a mediocre division is the fact that you just look at all of the teams and they're all terrible in different ways. So Calgary can capitalize if they get a run going.
So the first game of this week was a very popular game. There's a lot of Eastern fans who love to go to the Toronto games. And Chad Johnson made 39 saves. Freddie Hamilton, Christopher Stieg each scored in the first minute of the game to help the Flames shut out the Maple Leafs 3-0 on Wednesday. This was a fun game to watch. I think to me, this was a game where we really saw the team coming out and really, I would say, playing Flames hockey this year. What did you think?
Oh, I agree. Especially for the first period. After that, they kind of took their foot off the gas a bit just because there wasn't any need, really.
Yeah, well, that's
it. You got a 3-goal lead.
Yeah, and
okay,
and
come at me. And if you're not scoring, who cares?
And sometimes we see the Flames take their foot off the gas and lose the game because of it, where they tend to get tired out. But in this one, I thought that they were playing with the effort that they needed to. Yeah, they took their foot off the gas, but Toronto wasn't playing exceptionally well either. And so, you know, as long as you're playing better than your opponent, that's really all you have to do.
Mm-hmm. And even though Toronto outchanced the Flames in that game, realistically, even if they did score, I think the Flames would have turned it back on at that point.
Yeah,
they seem to be controlling the other team. Like, even though Toronto was dominating the play in the last two periods, it wasn't any real nervous feeling watching the game.
See, when I was watching, I thought, yeah, Toronto got more shots, but I thought Calgary had better quality shots in this one. They were putting more offensive pressure right, you know, from the hash marks down. They seemed to be doing more of the better things. And a lot of Toronto shots were shots that you're looking at going, that's not going in, that's not going in. But as I've said, every game this year, the Flames have success when they don't take penalties. And in this one, both teams had 4 penalty minutes. And it showed that, you know, we got huge success because of it. So I think that's the biggest thing, and we're still seeing that. We'll talk about that as we go through the week. But the Flames need to stay out of the penalty box.
Well, not only that, the penalty kill in recent games has also significantly improved. I think until the Kessler goal late in the third period, the Flames had only allowed 1 power play goal against in their previous 27 opportunities or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. I have to do the exact math. But, yeah, I mean, it's nice to see it improving, but you still don't want to use it if you don't have to.
True.
You know, it's a game designed to be played 5-on-5. So this was a fun game to watch for me. I thought it was fitting for Johnson to get a shutout in this one. He's been playing great lately, so it's nice to see him rewarded with that shutout. This is really the first time that most Western fans have seen the new-look Maple Leafs, if you will. Any impressions you have of some of the guys here, like Marner, Nylander, Matthews, this new young crop of Leafs?
Oh, they're going to be a good team for quite a while. It's just a matter of seeing what secondary pieces that they can get to surround those guys in order to determine whether or not they'll become a contending team or just a good team down the road.
Yeah, I think this team has potential to go somewhere, and I'm glad they're in the East.
True.
Because I don't want
anytime the Eastern teams get good players, it's like, fine, that's fine. We don't have to worry about them, so
that's
fine.
We can probably afford to lose to them once, maybe twice a year, but it's not going to affect us overall. So, overall, good game. Anything else about this game you wanted to mention? I thought it's worth noting that Freddie Hamilton got his first goal of the year, and Matt Stajan got his second goal of the year, so good to see those guys getting in there. Stajan's been playing really good, so I'm glad he's getting rewarded with a goal.
Yeah, how frustrating would that be if you were, say, parking your car and you got into the arena like a minute into the game and, what? Missed
yeah, exactly.
Two goals already?
Well, because even here at the Dome, right, like you see guys coming in 5-10 minutes late to the first period.
Yeah, just bizarre. It was the first time since 1987 that they scored twice in the opening minute against the Hartford Whalers.
That's
so
crazy.
You know it's a throwback win.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's fitting that it was Hamilton and Versteeg too. Like two guys that have been working hard lately. Versteeg's back in the lineup. So I always like to see guys get rewarded. But yeah, I was just sitting down and I see the goal. I'm like, okay, I can run to the bathroom because they're not going to score again. And just as I was in the bathroom, Versteeg scored.
Oh, I know. That kind of happened in the Anaheim game too, where if you left for 5 minutes, oh crap, what happened?
If you blink, yeah, you miss a goal. So after that, the Flames took on the Minnesota Wild. This was a game that we weren't sure how it was going to go. Chad Johnson stopped 2 of 3 shootout attempts after making 23 saves, and the Flames defeated the Wild 3-2 at the Scotiabank Saddledome on Friday. Versteeg scored another goal, a first-period goal, and a shootout goal. And, yeah, they were looking pretty good. The Flames' goals in this one came from Versteeg and Backlund, were the two regular season goals, or the regular time goals, I should say. And Versteeg scored the shootout. So, overall, I don't know. This game, I thought the Flames did well. They had more shots in the Wild. They had 10 minutes in the box. I didn't find, from what I saw of this game, I didn't watch the whole thing. I watched the last period. The Flames just seemed like they were kind of going through the motions. They didn't seem like they were really doing anything great or not great, but just kind of playing a system game, I guess.
Yeah, and in the first period, they got caught running around their own zone, and that's what led to the Stewart goal. But after that, they toned it down defensively. It like kept them out of their zone, other than like it shots off the rush, that kind of thing. No sustained pressure, and Calgary got 2 goals to take the lead. The second period was abysmally boring, but that too is perfectly fine when you've got the lead. You don't like exciting hockey when you're leading. Not true. Necessarily, unless you're paddling on like in the Anaheim game, but yeah, it is what it is, and they got caught running around in the third period, which led to the Koivu goal. Overall, other than those two shifts where they were not doing so well in their own zone, they played pretty much a pristine game defensively, and they weren't able to generate much offense, but you're also facing Dubnyk, who's probably the second best goaltender in the NHL right now.
Yeah, for sure. That was in that game, we had a couple notable scratches. We had Joki Paka playing and Brett Kulak scratched, and also Hunter Shinkarik scratched. And we'll talk more about him as we move forward. But Shinkarik sat out pretty much all week. And the next game, the one that people are going to be talking about for a long time, I think. And man, I wish this game was played at the Honda Center.
Well, you see, we got all of our goals out of the way, so that way when we go to Anaheim, you can expect us not to score at all.
That's right. I thought, like, can we pause this game and quickly ship everybody to Anaheim and keep going? Johnny Gaudreau back in the lineup as the Flames take on the Ducks on Sunday night, and the Flames ignited the Ducks. They really roasted them here in an 8-3 final. And if you were wearing a red jersey, you probably got a point in this one. The Flames got goals from Johnny Gaudreau, Troy Brouwer, Alex Chiasson, Matt Stajan, Sam Bennett, Dougie Hamilton, Sean Monahan, Mark Giordano were all the goal scorers. So pretty much everyone who's anyone on this team got a goal. Good to see both Gaudreau and Monahan getting on the board. Those guys both need some offense here, but wow, what a game.
Yeah, and boo to TJ Brody being a -1 in that game. How?
That's hard to do.
Yeah. Just got a rag on him, because why not?
Yeah. Ducks outshot the Flames as far as the scoreboard went, but the Flames definitely got the better of the Ducks in the end. I thought in this one the Ducks were really dominant for the first, I'd say, 10 minutes. The Flames got the early goal, but I thought the Ducks really clinched down. And probably the whole first period and about 10 minutes into the second, the Ducks, I thought, were really playing well. And then in the second period, it was just a terrible period for the Ducks, and the Flames took over.
Yeah, once Brouwer scored, that was it.
Yeah,
basically.
That opened the floodgates.
The tires fell off, the engine caught fire, and, you know, the bus exploded.
So if you look at the timing on this match, 5 goals in 6 minutes and 4 seconds.
That has to be dangerously close to a franchise record.
Yeah, I was looking at it. It's not quite a franchise record, but it's pretty close. I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah, like that. I've never seen that that I can recall.
No, so if we look at the times on the goals, Troy Brouwer scored 11:28 in the second. Alex Chiasson 11:20 in the second, so less than a minute later. 35 seconds later at 12:22, we get a staging goal. Then we waited a couple minutes. Bennett scored at 16:37 and Dougie Hamilton 17:32, so almost a minute apart there. And, yeah, as soon as this team went up 5-1, I knew that, you know what, if the Flames blow this, it's going to be the worst game of the season.
Yeah. Well, anytime you blow a 4-plus goal lead. Like, I remember that one game against Chicago back in 2009. Oh, yeah. Where it was 5-0 and they lost. It's like, what are you guys doing?
I know. But when is the last time you can remember the Flames having 5 unanswered goals in one period?
I honestly can't. And they had 7 unanswered goals total. You have to go back a couple of years when we did that to Edmonton.
Yeah. No, for sure. So good to see those guys firing up. Good to see Gaudreau back. I would love to find out and be a fly in the Ducks room for this one. What happened between the first and the second? Like, the Ducks just seemed to fall apart, and the Flames, I wouldn't say they played a fantastic game, but they capitalized where they needed to.
Yeah.
And this wasn't a fantastic Flames game.
Honestly, even with the goals that were surrendered, like, the only real stinker that Bernier let in was the first one to Gaudreau. Every other one was a tough go. Like, there was no easy save for him. Like, you had 2 deflection goals. You had another shot where he made the first save and then didn't get the rebound. The 2-on-0 breakaway, a pass across in the slot, point-blank shot. Like, there's nothing that Bernier could do with any of that.
No. So. And I'm not blaming it on the goalie. I mean, it's the whole team kind of fell apart.
Yeah, looked like the Flames defense from earlier in the season.
Yeah, it did. But, I mean, the question to me is, like, you know, what happened? How does a good team like the Ducks just fall apart so quickly?
Well, I think that the Anaheim Ducks are not as good as they have been in previous years. And, honestly, I think their window of opportunity is quickly fading. Because the secondary depth on the team is severely lacking.
Could be right. Yeah, they're definitely not the powerhouse they once were. The question I got a lot on Twitter today after that game is, why did the Ducks not change goaltenders? Why did they leave Bernie in there to just get shelled? And I was saying the same thing. After 4, you're thinking, okay, they'll switch goalies. After 5, you're thinking they'll switch goalies. After 6, it's like, why is the coach not switching goalies? So it turns out we found out John Gibson, who is the other goaltender dressed, had diarrhea, and the coach didn't want to put him in. And we thought this game was messy as it was. Put in a goalie with diarrhea, and it'll get even more messy.
Yeah, and that happens. Like, earlier in the season when Columbus shelled Montreal, Price, because he's still recovering from his injury, wasn't allowed to play on a back-to-back, and that's why they left him in there. And it was kind of obvious that the reason, there had to be some reason for them not switching the goaltenders, because mm-hmm. it's just not fair to the other guy. Like, if you're not having a good night or your team's not having a good night, like, it's not on you.
No. And, you know, this is, I think, one of those cases, and we've seen a few of them now already, that I think there's a need for a third goalie in the NHL, and I don't want to take up an extra roster spot, but I'd love to see the teams, and you mentioned this for the show, I'd love to see the teams expand the roster just to add one extra goalie. It can't be used for anything else but that, but you got to be careful who you carry. Like, we wouldn't want the Flames carrying Gillies as a third goalie who's not going to get any play. So I think that's where you'd see teams sign a Tom McCallum or even a Kari Ramo, going, you're never going to play, but you're traveling with the team, and in worst case scenario, at least you know the guy can probably do a better job than the local equipment manager who's the, you know, designated emergency goalie. What do you think, Matt?
Yeah, it's an option. Like, I think that, like, each team should just have, like, an in-arena goaltender that either team can use. just to save like travel expenses
yeah.
and all that kind
no,
of stuff.
No, that would work. I was thinking it has to be somebody of NHL quality because we've seen that before, but usually it's like a local.
Well, usually it's like former NCAA players or yeah. something like that. So like if you have one of those types who's recently retired from hockey, like what the Chicago Blackhawks used earlier in the week, like just have like each city have like a designated guy so that way like if either side needs them just to sit on the bench.
Yeah, well, I think there is a designate in every arena, but often it's a guy just on the bench, but you always are scared, please don't make this guy play. So I'd almost like to see it as being a recently retired NHLer.
You know, sort of like Dwayne Rolison that one time with
yeah,
Anaheim.
Yeah, Dwayne Rolison, or even like, you know, Toronto right now has Kari Ramo working out with them. Like, you know, he could do it in Toronto. Like, I just think of every team sort of had a recent NHL or AHL goalie who, you're right, is just assigned to the home games in that arena, but at least they're competent. So if you're like last night, okay, let's get our goalie out of there. You know, you don't want to put some NCAA call-up or Calgary Dinos call-up in, but, okay, let's put our, you know, our guy, our Joey McDonald in there, if you will, and at least he might be competent for that half game.
Mm-hmm.
We could maybe get Kelly Rudy to do it here in town.
I think he might have a little bit to say about that.
I wonder if he still got that old Jofa helmet that he wore. So looking at the team over the last week, I think there's some interesting storylines going on here. First one I wanted to mention to you, and you know I'm a fan of Versteeg. Versteeg and Monahan seemed to have quite a bit of chemistry when Gaudreau was out with his injury. Now that he's back, would you keep Versteeg with Monahan and maybe move Gaudreau around? Would you put the three of them together, or do you break them up entirely?
I leave. But when you get chemistry, you just let it rip. Like back in like the early 2000s with McCammond and Conroy, like those guys previous to that were third, fourth line players, but they clicked with Iginla in such a manner that they became one of the best lines in hockey. And Versteeg, Monahan, and Brouwer seem to be having it going right now. And you just, like a hot goaltender, you just let it rip until they start struggling, and then you mix it up after that. And Bennett, Gaudreau, and Chiasson played well. I think they had three goals between them last night. You can't really complain about those results, so just see how it goes. And
yeah, for sure.
If you can roll three separate lines that have dangerous offensive talent on it, you're going to have favorable matchups because you can't have like the other team's top two pairings of defensemen play 30 minutes a night each. Like that's just not reasonable.
And it's nice to have options.
You're going to be getting them to face their version of Englund and Kulak, whichever, you know, team you're facing.
Yeah.
And that makes things a little easier for you.
And I think it's nice to have options. If Versteeg, Monahan aren't doing well, then you can drop Johnny on the line with Monahan. Like, you can mix and match as needed to throw teams off. But Versteeg was kind of brought in here, as we talked about at the beginning of the year, to be that number one guy to play with Monty and Gaudreau. And I think that even him and Monty, as long as it's working, why not? I would love to see Versteeg have a good year this year with the Flames.
And, you know, at any time things, like, say Versteeg just starts struggling to a ridiculous extent, maybe you throw Ferland on that line.
Yeah,
just
well,
to switch
I mean, if
it
Chiasson
up, like,
keeps looking good, maybe give him another shot, too.
Yeah, so it just depends. Like, if somebody's cold, give somebody on the fourth line a shot in their spot and see how it goes. Like, Lance Boma's going to be returning soon. Maybe you insert him in that upper line spot instead.
So after an 8-3 win over a team like the Ducks, who I think you're right, they're starting to slip, but they are still seen as one of the better teams in the NHL, what does that do for the morale? Like, I can only imagine the Flames are going to come out for the Dallas game just pumped, and I think this might be that sign to everybody that, hey, we're turning around and we can actually do this.
Well, that's the main thing to look at, is now that the team is back at 500 at 13-13-2,
we've erased all our mistakes at this point.
Yeah, so we're starting over. And it's just like at the conclusion of the 7-game winning streak last year, it was the same story, and then the team promptly fell on their face and erased all the good that they did. So while the results recently have been spectacular. Okay, now you've hit the zero mark again. Now you have to build on it. And, well, you know, you can't say that it's going to be this or it's going to be that. You just have to see how the team itself responds.
We spend a lot of time getting ourselves out of the hole we dug ourselves in.
Yeah, and it's a minor miracle that, you know, 2 games into December and we've already zeroed out the start from the beginning of the season. I frankly thought it would take more towards the end of the month or into January if they were able to. So they're well in advance of where I was expecting them to be. So it just, with the weaker schedule in terms of opponents, they have an opportunity to go on a protracted roll and, you know, take the first spot in the division and hold it. But,
and we all said for a while that one of the biggest problems for the Flames was they weren't getting the practice time in. And we're still seeing them. I mean, you know, even this week they're playing every other day. Last week they were playing a ton. But with, you know, we have a 3-day break coming up on the 11th, 12th, 13th. We have some more breaks coming up, like the weekend off on the 17th, 18th, and the 21st, 22nd. I think you're going to start to see this team only get better from here as they're on the ice more, as they're feeling more comfortable with each other, as they're getting healthy again and getting, you know, Boma back in the lineup, Gaudreau back in the lineup. I think if this team falters at this point, if we don't stay at 500 or above, we really have to now start looking at, okay, what is the issue?
For sure. And the goaltending has been there all year. And the defense was just abysmal. But now the defense has tightened up and the team's getting results. Now, if
we've already changed the coach, we changed the GM a few years ago. So if this team still can't make it, I think this is where now you start looking at inside the locker room.
Yeah. And see, like, what is the deficiency? And like early in the season, it was team defense that has evaporated. And so if they do falter, it will be incumbent to see what exactly is the cause of, like, say, like Chad Johnson and Elliott both falter. Well, then the goaltenders are on a cold streak. So then that makes sense. But it could be the defense goes bad again or nobody can score. It just, it would depend on what, but we're not there yet, so.
So talking about one of the keys to victory and what this team has changed, I think the biggest thing that happened for them is Johnny Gaudreau coming back. He came back in the Anaheim game, and Gaudreau must not only be Johnny Hockey, but Superman. This guy was out for about 18 days, and this was an injury that's supposed to take 6 weeks to heal. So I'm hoping that he's healed and ready to go, and they're not just rushing him back in, because with the amount of money that this team now has tied up in Gaudreau, I'd hate for him to be rushed back and see some repercussion of that later on in his career.
Yeah. Well, I know that there has been some advancement in terms of repairing, like, broken bones and such, where it doesn't take quite as long. And we also don't know the extent of the fracture as well. So it could have just been a relatively minor one, or, you know, some advanced medical technique, or he's playing through an injury, and we'll see. But I like his new gloves, and I actually hope that he keeps them afterwards, because he will continue to get whacked in the hands.
Yeah, and I think that'll be the biggest thing, is to make sure that going forward we don't see him keep getting whacked in the hands. That could cause issues there. So the Flames are going to have to maybe change up his line mates or do something there to keep that from happening. But you were saying that he was like a Ninja Turtle in that game. He had three fingers.
Yeah, his glove was modified to, like, I'm assuming that two of the fingers were taped, like his broken pinky and the other one.
Yeah, I think it'd be tough for a trainer to re-sew a glove.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's, so you
probably a specialty thing.
Could be. So his fingers were taped together, but he was back, and he looked good. Like, he didn't look like he'd missed a step, and that was my worry, is, okay, when this guy comes back, how long is it going to take him to get back into the groove of things, considering he hasn't really been in his groove this season. But to me, this was, you know, Johnny Gaudreau from last season. This was Gaudreau looking fantastic.
Yeah, and it is what it is. Like, when you have a player that's that good, a broken pinky isn't going to deter them too much. So it's not like he relies on his slap shot to be the primary driver of the goal. He primarily uses his wrist shot anyway, so that's not a big deal.
No, but I mean, he makes his living with his hands, and you've got to...
True.
You want to make sure that for a kid like that, I mean, without his hands, he's not worth much to this team. So for an asset locked up as long as he is, we got to protect those hands.
Yep. And that's why you're going to see him likely be surrounded by line mates and such that, you know, touch him and die.
Exactly. Maybe they'll call McGrattan back up. Or where's that?
Or stick a chuck on him.
Where's Christoph Oliwa when we need him?
Yeah.
So the other notes on the lineup, Michael Ferlin left the Anaheim game midway through with what we believed is a wrist injury. The coach says that he'll be fine and will be making the trip to Dallas. Also making the trip to Dallas will be Lance Boma, and he's expected to rejoin the team. Matt, I don't know about you. I'm not really sure about Boma. I mean, he's a good player, but he always seems like he's injured. And I think at this point, I don't know if he's a long-term flame. He doesn't seem that reliable. And especially this year and last year, his production's gone down. I just don't know where you fit him into this lineup long-term.
Well, with him, I think that moving forward, I could see a trade happening. Like, if the number six defenseman on the Flame continues to struggle, because both Joki Paka and Kulak have been rather inconsistent this year, that if that's the case, I could see a trade where Boma gets flipped for a solid number six defenseman.
See, I'd almost keep him and dangle him in the expansion draft and hope they take him over somebody like Shinkarik.
Yeah, I could see that too. It just depends on the who, what, and where. And if he comes back and plays well, then hey, awesome. But Garnett Hathaway is doing a bang-up job in his own right, so, you know, Boma's got to fight for his spot in the lineup.
Was it? With the amount he's been injured, I think he kind of lost the spot that was his to Hathaway, to, you know, other call-up guys both this year and last year, so it's going to take him more time to get in the lineup. But looking at who we have, I think Chiasson has filled in a lot of what Boma's role was very well. And I guess I would not be surprised if Dougie Hamilton slots in the lineup over Boma in some of the current games. Freddie Hamilton, yeah. I just think he's going to do... I think that we know more what we have there, and he seems to be a little more solid.
And, well, he's only 2 years removed from a 16-goal season, so you always give the guy another shot to see if he can rekindle the magic, but if it's not there, the Flames do have plenty of other options.
And speaking of Boma coming back, that means the Flames had to make room on the roster for him. Hunter Shinkarik has been sent back down to Stockton. To me, I think there's a good move. I think Shinkarik wasn't playing a lot. He sat out most of the games recently. I think it's better for him to go down to Stockton and play a big role than sit on the bench here. I don't think he's done by any means. It's just not his time right now.
Yeah. And Shinkarik, he's one of those prospects that he probably won't be a full-time NHLer till he's 23 or 24.
Well, I definitely think he'll be a full-time Flame, but yeah.
Same here. It's just one of those things that, like, right now he's not better than other options. So you send him back down and let him tear up the A and earn his way back up.
Yeah, I think, you know, depending on the kind of player they need, I think he's one of the first recalls again later in the season. And, you know, if you look at what we gave up for him, which was Granlund, and Granlund was by that point a full-timer, I think that we're going to get a better long-term player out of Shinkarik than we would have if we kept Granlund.
Well, honestly, I think that Freddie Hamilton would have taken Granlund's spot if he was still in our organization, and I think Vancouver's just playing him because they have nobody else. So, you know, even if Shinkarik doesn't amount to anything, I don't think that Granlund would have either.
Yeah, I don't know. I think Granlund in the right organization can thrive. I think he's a few years away from thriving, and I don't know Vancouver's the right place for him. But I've always liked the kid, and I thought he had some potential.
Same here, but he's getting to the point where he needs to start putting up results, and that hasn't really been the case with any regularity.
True. So, Matt, here's a game I was playing on the weekend. I asked myself, okay, we're 28 games in. Who are the top goal assistant points getters for the Flames right now? And the answers might surprise you. Who do you think is the top goal getter for the Flames?
I would have to say Sean Monahan, but it could be either Sam Bennett or Troy Brower.
No, it's Monahan with 7 goals after the Ducks game. Next up is Frolik with 6, and Bennett also has 6, Brower has 6, Gaudreau has 6, Tkachuk has 6. So there's a big tie for second place, but Monahan has the most. Who do you think is leading the team in assists right now?
Giordano?
Close. Dougie Hamilton. So for everyone who's still down on Hamilton, he has 10 assists to date with 13 points total. Next after him is Frolik, and then Bennett, both tied at 9. Giordano has 8, and Brower, Gaudreau, Stajan are all tied at 7 for 4th place. So good to see Hamilton putting some points up there.
Yeah, well, he's at the very minimum, Dougie Hamilton will be Dennis Weidman.
Hopefully a faster version
offense.
Of Dennis Weidman.
Yeah, well, just in terms of generating offense. And as we've seen for most of this year, he's been pretty much on par offensively as he is defensively. And I think he's actually been Calgary's best player as a defenseman this season.
I was going to say, the best defenseman, yeah, in a lot of ways. I think that this is a good hire, and we've talked the last 2 years about getting rid of him. I think if you look at the cost we paid to get him and the way that he's shaping up, I don't think there's any way this guy's going anywhere anytime soon.
No, and we talked about those rumors of him being traded last week, and then, like, the day after we recorded, we all heard what Brian Burke had to say, and that was quite amusing.
It was. Some idiot GM who leaked this.
Yeah. So, suffice it to say, he was none too pleased with...
No, but, you know, I like that having Berkey in the organization, he can be that guy. My friend described him as the senile old man. Berkey can be the guy that comes out without the tie on and with the bad hair and rants and raves, and Tree Living doesn't get his hands dirty.
Yep.
And I think that's an interesting perspective to be in, because Tree Living can still make deals. He can still talk to the other GMs, and he wasn't the one that said it.
Yeah, that's just Berkey being Berkey.
Exactly. Oh, sorry, it was Brian again. You know, so I think it's an interesting dynamic to sort of have Berkey be the bad guy and Tree Living be the good guy.
Yep.
So going on the looking at the current Flames and who has how many points, Matt, to date, who do you think has the most points in a Flaming Sea this season?
Sam Bennett,
you're right. He's tied at the top with 15 points. Who do you think he's tied with?
I think it's Frolik, because I know he was leading for a while. Yep. I just know Bennett's been on a little bit of a tear lately.
Frolik and Bennett both have 15. At second place, we have Monahan, Brower, Gaudreau and Hamilton all tied at 13 points. So
now here's one for you. The Flames have 13 players with more than 10 points, and only the New York Rangers have more players with 10 points, and nobody else has more than 10.
Wow.
So the Flames are definitely scoring by committee.
They are. And that's what you need. I mean, to be a successful team, especially to be a team that goes deep, you need to have that by committee.
Yeah, and that's why, like, having the three lines separated where you're not concentrating all your talent on one line or two lines helps, because one of those three groupings is going to be playing against some crappy defensemen at some point in the game, and you can, if you have all three lines being able to score, then whomever is getting that favorable matchup can actually do some damage.
And interesting you mentioned that. So the guys without 10 points, the guys who are below that threshold, Dennis Weidman, not surprising to me. TJ Brody, usually I'd expect him to be above that, but he's been carrying Weidman's weight around this year, and that's why he's a negative minus 16. So I'm hoping some changes there. England.
Well, most of that was early in the season, though. So,
yeah,
like, he's been hovering around that since like the beginning of November.
Yeah, we'll see how he turns around. I think that they need to switch his partner up a bit for him to be much more successful. Derek England has 6 goals, not surprising. Six points. Yoki Pack has 5 points, not surprising. He's not playing much. Hathaway's got 3 points. Kulak has 3. Freddie Hamilton has 1, which was the goal he scored this week. Boma has 1. Shinkarik has 1. And Van Jankowski have none. So really all the impact players are putting up the points this year.
Yeah, and nobody seems to be really running away with the scoring lead, although I'm assuming that Gaudreau will be doing that imminently. But
well, that's it. Gaudreau has 13 points, so I think now that he's back, he's going to run away with it.
Mm-hmm.
And good to see Matt Stajan in that list of guys who have 10 or more. He's been working his butt off this year.
Yeah, and good for him. Like at this rate, he may even earn yet another contract, which I honestly was not sure if at the end of his deal next year, if he would get another NHL contract, but
I think he'll get a contract somewhere. I don't think we re-sign him because he's too rich for our blood.
Yeah, I think Jankowski will take his spot in the lineup.
Well, and I still maintain, I've said this since the beginning of the year, just looking that they have to get to the floor, I think he's a prime target for the Golden Knights.
Yeah, same here.
They have a cap floor to get to, and he's expensive. So bring him in for a year, see what you want to do with him after that.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm assuming that the Golden Knights will be doing a lot of, is poaching mediocre guys on one-year deals that,
and especially
well, not Stage, necessarily mediocre players, but like
especially if Stage looks good this year, he becomes a more attractive target.
Yeah.
Good for Frolik, though. I mean, we brought him in. We weren't really sure what to expect of him. He was always said that he was more of a defensive guy than an offensive guy. And we've talked a few times this year, but I think that Frolik is... could make a case for being one of the Flames' best forwards this year. And I think that they finally found a chemistry there with him, Backlund, and Tkachuk.
Well, frankly, him and Backlund are basically the same player. Just one's a center, one's a winger. So them playing off of each other, it seems like a fit that's such an easy fit together, because they seem to both be that good two-way, somewhat offensive, but primarily defensive player. It's just interesting, that's all.
And, I mean, they've really been the best line, the line of Tkachuk, Backlund, Frolik this year, better than even our first line. So, like you were saying, it's great to have...
Well, according to Corsi ratings, only the Crosby line and the Patrice Bergeron line have been better than them this season out of all the lines in the NHL.
Yeah, and if you look, even the score mentioned it. The score did a breakdown of the Corsi Hockey 5 best most dominant lines, and they're in there. So really good to see that. You know, these are guys that we've talked about, Backlund, you know, sort of finding his role as a two-way guy, and you need that second, third line wherever you look at these guys who can play that way. And I'm glad to see that Tkachuk found a line that he naturally fell into.
Yeah, and that chemistry... having that one gritty guy with the two more finesse types seems to be working really well, and hopefully that continues. And what better line for Tkachuk to learn how to be a complete NHLer than to be with two of the premier defensive forwards in the NHL?
Yeah, I think it'll work well, and I don't think he'll necessarily be there forever, but I think for this year and next year, that's a line that I think the coaches will stick with.
Doesn't hurt.
So Matt, looking at the Flames and kind of thinking back, I was doing some reflection over last week and thinking of where we are and where we are in the lineup and where our holes are and where they've been in the past, and going back through some notes. And if you think about the Flames, and we talked about this, the biggest overhaul in the offseason was goaltending. We pretty much got rid of everybody except for Gillies and replaced everybody. Like, it was pretty much over one summer, the entire position got replaced in the organization. And they've done a heck of a job, just looking at some of the stats behind this. Chad Johnson, who was brought in to be the backup, it looks like he's now the quality starter. In 15 games, he's 10-4-1. He has a 2.1 GAA, 9.28 save percentage, 3 shutouts.
Can't complain.
Brian Elliott, 13 games played, 3-9-1. He has a 3.31 goals against average and 0 shutouts. I mean, that on paper is a great
tandem. And like if you're just looking at the stats, you go, wow, Brian Elliott's terrible again. But when he was getting most of the starts was also coincidentally when the team was playing really, really terrible. So, and we've only seen him, I think, twice since the team has been playing well. So if he can get in a game at some point, and hopefully with his new white pads, he can start chipping away at those numbers and maybe put up a bit of a fight to get his spot back.
Well, just looking at how much hockey the Flames played till the end of the month, I think he'll get a couple starts. They've got a back-to-back on the 19th, 20th, but they play a lot of hockey this month. And I'm confident with either of those guys, but even as we look down at the AHL, I mean, we've got John Gillies, David Rittich, both guys looking fantastic. Rittich has two shutouts down there. Gillies doesn't have any yet. I think Gillies is still looking like he needs some seasoning time. He's not quite ready, but we're just hoping for an injury-free season out of him. But David Rittich, I think, was a great signing from overseas. He's doing a really good job as the backup. And two shutouts, not bad at all. And then the ECHL, Mason McDonald's down there. He's 12 games played. He's 7-2-3 at this point. He has a 2.62 GAA, 0.896 save percentage, and zero shutouts. He's not putting up the kind of numbers you'd expect, but you can never put in a ton of stock in ECHL goalies, I don't think.
Anytime you have a goaltender that's under the age of 24 or 25, it's a crapshoot from year to year. And as long as like each of the guys that has a pedigree, Gillies, Parsons, and McDonald, and they're quality goaltenders. Now, whether they turn it on and develop into quality NHL talent is still to be seen, but that's also why you continue to add goaltenders into your organization yearly until you get one. But, you know, with each of Gillies and McDonald not being off to the starts that you'd like, it's not that big of a deal.
I think it was good McDonald turned pro. I think he needed that pro turn, and there's no point in rushing this guy. It's not like we need the next starter now. We can take our sweet time with both these guys, I think.
Yeah, well, look at how long it took for Ordeo to crack the NHL, and he wasn't able to find any consistency at the NHL level, and that's why the Flames moved on. But you have three guys that are fairly decent in the organization. You just gotta wait and see, and like if nobody develops, then you can always just sign a veteran guy until one of them or somebody else you draft turns into the guy.
And the last guy on the list and at the pro level is Tom McCollum, who I don't think sticks around. I think he was signed, as everyone else does, just to be able to expose some goaltender this year. I mean, he's okay, but you'll get lost in a depth chart that's as deep as ours. And then, obviously, at the junior level, we have Parsons and Schneider both playing there. So it's, I guess, in the end, I just wanted to round these guys up and just say it's nice to have depth in that position again. After Kipper leaves, anytime you get that kind of franchise goalie leaving, there's always a bit of a transition period. And I think that we're now in a good spot again for this team and goalies.
Well, for the last few years, it felt like the late 90s after the Flames traded Vernon. And it's like, who's in net now?
Yeah. Well, or even the years when we're like, okay, Brathwaite's our guy, or Reggett's our guy.
Yeah.
You know,
again, and, who?
Yeah, just going through a revolving door of goaltenders. Tyler Moss.
Tyrone Gerdner.
That's right. So
Dwayne Rollison, J.S. Jaguar.
And I mean, guys had potential, and on paper they were good the last couple of years, didn't live up to it. But this now I think we have goaltenders that, you know, and even if Elliott doesn't end up being the starter all year, I'm more than confident with him whenever he needs to fill in. So any comments you had on our goaltenders?
Well, just hoping that like Elliott gets some support when he plays, and that's about it.
I think it's a very different looking team now, as you mentioned, than last time we really saw Elliott net, and I think that if you put him in, I don't think this team's going to play a lot differently.
Yeah, well, just like I couldn't really blame Bernier for a lot of yesterday's goals against, it was the same kind of situation for most of the time that Elliott was playing, where like he'd make the first save and even the second save, but then the third shot would go in. Well, what do? Like, you can't blame the goalie on that. It's on the defense for not clearing the puck. So, and a lot of the goals were that kind of thing where Elliott would make the first stop and allow the rebound in because the defense wasn't playing well. So now the defense is playing well. Hopefully when Elliott draws in that he is able to stop the puck and the rebound gets cleared if there is any.
Maybe we just have to have our goalies wear white pads. I think if we did the research, historically Flames goalies in white pads do better.
Yeah. The ghost of Jonas Hiller has been put to rest.
Well, and even Kipper wore primarily white pads. I think the last goalie that did much of anything in dark pads was probably Kidder. I'd have to go back.
And even then, you know.
Well, at the time, he was good for what we needed.
True.
You know, they weren't often a playoff team, and the goalie wouldn't have helped them at that point a lot. Tabby had some dark pads. I'd have to go back and see, but I think most of our guys have. I think, no, Turek wore dark pads, too. He had those circles on it. So, yeah, I think ever since Turek, if you look, the good goalies have probably had the light pads. So maybe that should be a rule. It's like Berkey's stupid, you know, 0 to 25 number rule or whatever. If you want to goaltend here, light pads.
Yeah.
So I think the only big news besides the games this past week was the Flames Super Skills competition, which they held at the Dome. It's been a while since they've done the Super Skills, and I think it's good they're doing it again. I think it's another fan touch point, especially for minor hockey players and families. So it's a great event to have. The Flames were split into two teams, Team Red and Team White. And overall, Team Red came out on top, winning most of the events. So I just thought I'd go through some of the winners and the results here. And Matt, have you looked at the results?
No, not at all.
So why don't you try to guess who won each one of these? Fastest skater on the team. This was judged by starting center ice and skating one full lap.
Bennett.
Bennett came in second. The winner was Michael Backlund at 13.78 seconds.
Wow.
Bennett was less than a second different, 13.97 seconds. Shinkarik was third, Hathaway was fourth, Boma was fifth, and Kulak was sixth.
Not the bad. Next,
yeah, not really the guys I was expecting to be in that list.
No.
But, you know, I mean, you never know who's feeling what after a few games. But, yeah, I mean, to have Garnet Hathaway and Hunter Shinkarik in that list, not the guys I was expecting to be there. The next event was the Relay Challenge. Players would skate the full length of the ice and then skate through a course of pylons with a puck. And in this one, there was a head-to-head. And who do you think the top two guys in this one were?
I would guess Gaudreau and Monahan.
I was thinking the same thing. They were put on opposite teams. It was actually Freddie Hamilton and Jyrki Ilkka-Pekka.
Okay.
So they won Heat 1 head-to-head. Heat 2 was won by Sean Monahan and TJ Brody. Matt Stajan and Michael Frolik and Shinkarik and Tkachuk were all in Heat 2. And then Heat 3, which was the ultimate head-to-head, it sounds like, was Versteeg and Gaudreau. Now, I imagine these guys probably aren't going 100% either, especially a guy like Gaudreau, you know, coming off an injury. Here's the one I found most interesting, though, was the shooting accuracy. The players stood in the high slot, took passes, alternating from each corner, and they must hit four targets placed in each corner of the net within a certain time period. Best accuracy on the team went to Alex Chiasson, who got four targets in six attempts. Sean Monahan had two targets in eight attempts. And believe it or not, Dennis Wideman got four targets in eight attempts. Better than Tkachuk and Gaudreau.
So yeah, I was actually going to joke that I was going to say that Wideman probably got zero targets, but...
No, he got four and eight, so 50%. But, you know, he's not being chased by anybody. It's easy to plant your feet and hit those targets, right?
Yeah, well, one of the things that Wideman was always good at was getting pucks through the defender up until this past season and this year. So hopefully he can avoid shooting it directly into the guy in front of him. But we'll see.
Yeah, if you can just do it in the super skills, that's one thing. But that's not really what we're looking for. And then this is the one I'm always interested in, the hardest shot. Who do you think's got the hardest shot this year?
Well, I actually did hear about this and that was Backlund.
Backlund's at 103.3. Furland was pretty close at 103.2.
Which really surprises me because I've always considered Backlund to have a weaker shot. Like, I've never really considered him to have, like, a really blistering slap shot.
But again, these are in ideal conditions, right? They're not game conditions. I mean, I bet any of these guys at the NHL level could shoot it about that hard if you want to.
True. It just seems atypical for, like, game results because, like, I can only think of a couple of times where he actually wired a shot past the goaltender. Yeah.
I don't think you'd ever see Backlund doing that when he's trying to skate and watch the play and all that sort of thing. But Furland was, 0.1 mile per hour below him, and I wouldn't think of Furland as having that either.
No.
So I think in sort of lab conditions, if you will, it doesn't surprise me. And then Troy Brouwer at 98.2. I imagine Brouwer could go a bit more than that. Giordano at 100. Hamilton was 100.7. And England 97.0. So these are lab conditions. That's what we have to remember about those. But overall, fun event from what I've heard. I wasn't there, but a lot of families enjoyed it. And they had some minor hockey kids on the ice with the players. So I imagine that was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for these kids that they won't soon forget.
Yeah. One story I did hear was apparently TJ Brody participated in one of the Toronto Maple Leafs super skills type competitions when he was a young kid, and he was put in the accuracy shooting, and he actually went 4 for 4.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
If I recall, none of the Leafs did. So, yeah.
He's better than most of the Leafs.
Yeah. Even when he was 10 years old.
I'd love to see the kids doing the same thing in Edmonton. And, what kind of results they get against the others.
That's the reason why they don't do that. Because, you don't want to upstage the NHL team.
You could put the Timbits out there and they'd probably still do better. Outside of that, some more World Junior news. We talked a little bit last week, but some more Flames who have been named to at least preliminary junior rosters. Shillington and Karnikov were named to Sweden. And Tyler Fox and Adam Parsons to the U.S. roster. So I don't know who will actually make those rosters. Do you think the Flames would let Shillington go?
Oh, for sure. If you're not in the NHL, you go, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the AHL team would probably be a good test to not have him for a week.
Yep.
Parsons and Fox, I could see them both making that team. Interesting was Tuutola not named to the Finnish team. They released their roster and he wasn't on there. But
well, Finland's been a bit better with their player development lately, so
yeah,
that's not really a surprise. Like, I actually wouldn't be surprised if they won the tournament this year.
They definitely could. I'm looking at Finland as one of the teams. They're stacked. They could definitely take it.
Yeah, I think the three top are Canada, USA, and Finland this year.
Yeah, I think Sweden will come close. I don't think they'll get it done. It depends who's on the roster.
Same with Russia. Like, they have decent amounts of talent, but I just think that, it's not at the same level. Like, they could win, but, it would be an upset to do
so. Yeah, that's it. I think somebody would have to have a bad tournament for Russia to win.
Yeah, I think several teams would have to have a bad tournament for Russia to win. But I think they're the weakest of the five we mentioned.
Probably. Well, I think that's it for Flames news this week. Why don't we look ahead to the week that's coming? And if we take a look back at our predictions for last week, there was 6 points on the board. For the first time this year, Matt, the Flames got every point they possibly could.
And if you would have said that, considering we're playing Anaheim this week, I would have thought you were crazy, but...
We gave up a point, but we still got 6 of the 6. Yep. You predicted the exact opposite. You predicted 0 points for the week.
Well, I did that intentionally, you see, because I've been exactly wrong, I think, 3 or 4 times this week or this year. So
should I just put you down for zeros for the rest of the year?
Well, maybe for quite a while anyway. But I think for this week, I'll probably go with 2 points, but we'll get to that.
Sure. So we got three games this week. The Flames take on the Dallas Stars in Dallas on Tuesday. That's a 6:30 Mountain start time. On Thursday, we take on the Arizona Coyotes in Arizona. It's a 7 p.m. start time. And then Saturday the 10th, the Flames are back here in the Dome where we take on the Winnipeg Jets. And looking at this historically, we do pretty well against the Jets and the Stars. Stars is always a good game. Arizona, we seem to struggle against, and I don't know why.
Defensive systems. That's and decent goaltending just seem to stifle our forwards, so it is what it is.
So, Matt, I'm going to go bold this week. I'm thinking the Flames get all six of their possible points. I think after the Anaheim game, especially with Gaudreau fresh, I think that we're going to roll into Dallas and play a great game. I think they'll roll that momentum over the Coyotes and the same over the Jets. So I'm going to go 6 of 6.
Yeah, I'll go with 2. I'll say that they beat Dallas and that's it. Just to, you know, be contrary.
And even if that happens, they have to play good games all week in order to keep this momentum up. Like, you can lose and still have a good, strong hockey game.
Yeah. I agree.
So make sure the Flames are doing that. And then next week they come home for two more against Tampa and Columbus. And, I mean, this team's looking good. So if you need tickets for these games, if you want to go see Winnipeg or Tampa Bay or Columbus, make sure you check out our friends at TickTix. You can download their app on iOS or Android. Great place to get tickets from verified buyers. They're all season ticket guys. And also think about not just for you now, but think about these tickets make great holiday gifts. So we've got a ton of home games in January. Why not buy a pair of tickets for somebody? And it's one of these things, buy low, sell high. If you buy now, I bet you'll get better prices than if you wait a week, considering how the team's been playing. So buy your tickets now, use TickTix, and hopefully everyone will get out to the Dome this year. It's always fun to go, and I really envy the people that got to go to the Ducks game. That would have been a fun game to be at.
I agree. Thanks for listening, everybody, and have a good week.
Let's hope this momentum continues.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how the team does.
Talk to you next week, Matt.
Take care.
This has been another Fireside Chat. Don't forget to subscribe to the show at firesidechat.ca. Follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/firesidechat. And to follow us on Twitter at Fireside Podcast. Catch our show on the podcast channel at thehockeywriters.com. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-alike license. Hosted by Dan Stevenson and Matt Dubor. Produced and edited by Peter Marino and Ryan Coetz.